vomiting sets in until this particular woman cannot do anything, then here comes the stress, particularly when there's severe nausea and severe vomiting until now this particular pregnant woman is about to go into shock. She cannot do anything in the family and all family members are scared. Now, today we are going to learn about hyperemesis gravidarum, that is severe nausea and vomiting in pregnancy. And if you love this channel, click this red button, written subscribe, turn it on for more videos that we post, and make sure you watch this video up till the end, because we are going to discuss about causes and way we can manage this hyperemesis gravidarum. Hyperemesis gravidarum, we are going to look at causes, risk factors, signs and symptoms, and management. This is your host, Family Vlogs. Welcome to this channel and subscribe to it. Morning sickness and HG are very different condition, and we define this hyperemesis gravidarum as an extreme form of morning sickness that causes severe nausea and vomiting during pregnancy. They have different complication and side effect for each woman. We should be able to distinguish it from morning sickness and occurs at first trimester and last more than morning sickness, may last in the whole pregnancy or even after birth. So we must look this into details in terms of management of this hyperemesis gravidarum. Causes and risk factors. Exact causes of hyperemesis gravidarum is unknown, but there are risk factors linked to genetics, that is elevated beta HCG level, that is human chorionic gonadotropin. High levels are found around 8 to 12 weeks, then decline. Postulation theories: increased in maternal estrogen, decreasing intestinal motility and gastric emptying, leading to nausea and vomiting. Risk factors of hyperemesis gravidarum are first pregnancy, multiple pregnancy, obesity, prior or family history of hyperemesis gravidarum, diseases like trophoblastic disorders, pregnancy related tumors, e.g. hiartiformal, choriocarcinoma, placentocyte trophoblastic tumors, and epithelial trophoblastic tumors. Eating disorders like bulimia nervosa, that when you eat a lot and you get rid of food in terms of inducing vomiting, is a disorder, may cause this hyperemesis gravidarum. So we should even take note of these risk factors, and they normally help us in managing. Signs and symptoms of this problem is that there is severe nausea and vomiting that may result to loss of 5% of pregnancy body weight, to dehydration causing ketosis and constipation, nutritional disorders like vitamin B1, vitamin B6, vitamin B12 deficiencies, metabolic imbalances like ketoacidosis and thyrotoxicosis set in, physical and emotional stress, difficult with activity of daily living. Symptoms may be aggravated by hunger, fatigue, premarital vitamins, e.g. those containing iron, and diet. Many women with hyperemesis gravidarum are extremely sensitive to odors in their environment. Certain smell exacerbates symptoms. Excessive salivation, that is sialorrhea gravidarum, may be appreciated in some women. So we must take this as into consideration for better management of this particular woman, so that we relieve this stress of hyperemesis gravidarum. Diagnosis of hyperemesis gravidarum, its diagnosis of exclusion, that is we normally use differential diagnosis together with history and physical exams, and then we do lab works. Of course, we have differential diagnosis like infection, malaria, urinary tract infection, hepatitis, meningitis, gastroenteritis, even metabolic disorders like DKA, that is diabetic ketoacidosis, then hyperparathyroidism may be evident. And again, we may consider GI disorders with abdominal pain as a differential, like appendicitis and cholecystitis, together with pancreatitis, even fatty liver or peptic ulcer disease, and even small bowel obstruction may set in. Of course, gestational trophoblastic disorders or diseases or tumors like molar pregnancy or choriocarcinoma may also mimic this hyperemesis gravidarum. So when we are managing a patient, we must consider differential diagnosis to make us manage this patient very well. Laboratory investigations of hyperemesis gravidarum. On the bedside, we may consider weight and compare it with the previous one. Even we do urine dipstick for quantifying ketonuria. Lab works, that is midstream urine, then full blood count to elicit whether there is anemia or any other infection. Urea creatinine and electrolytes, that is, we check about hyperkalemia, hyponatremia, dehydration, and even renal disease. Blood glucose like DKA is very, very important, and also even ruling out liver disease, that is hepatitis and gallstone. Amylase will help us in ruling out pancreatitis, and even we can do thyroid function test to rule out hypo or hyperthyroidism. Arterial blood glucose, arterial blood gas, sorry, is very, very important to rule out any metabolic disturbances and monitor severity. So these lab works are very, very important in managing this particular patient. Obstetric and pelvic scan is very, very important. That is, ultrasound is done to confirm the viability of the fetus, confirm gestation, rule out multiple pregnancy, and even gestational trophoblastic diseases like H-mold, that is hyadatiform mold. So this is very, very important. And when we suspect there is a hyperemesis gravidarum, we must rule out by doing the following laboratory investigations. Of course, management of hyperemesis gravidarum depends with the severity of symptoms, and we might consider mild to be managed in the community level with oral antiemetics like Placil. Even oral rehydration, we encourage a patient to take a lot of water, to drink a lot of fluids. Even dietary advice like dry food and even ginger. Of course, we will do reassurance for this particular patient so that she will be knowing that this condition do happen. But severe hyperemesis gravidarum, we normally do rehydration with normal saline, even Hartmann solutions. And this one help us to replace the electrolyte loads. Antiemetics, we give them according to first line, second line, or third line. First line, we have the drugs as it appears. Second line, we have metoclopramide, domperidone, even ondansetron. Of course, third line will initiate hydrocortisone, and then taper the dose of prednisolone as the condition is improving in this particular patient. So it's very, very necessary to consider all those medication. Other medication like H2 receptors antagonist or proton pump inhibitors for reflux or esophagitis or even gastritis. Thiamine, that is vitamin B1, is very, very important, because if you vomit a lot, you normally deplete vitamin B1 within 2 weeks. So it's very, very important. Of course, we'll dispense folic acid just to prevent neural tube defect. And also we can do parenteral nutrition or enteral nutrition via NG tube or nosogastrial tube. Of course, we'll cover the patient on thromboprophylaxis for all women requiring admission, that is thromboembolic stockings may be introduced, or even low molecular weight heparin may be used as to measure to prevent any formation of blood clot. Of course, all these drugs will be managing. We will be managing this particular patient case by case. Now, it's necessary that all these drugs listed must be dispensed to this particular patient. So it will be case by case management. So, complication of hyperemesis gravidarum, if not properly managed, can arise into anemia, kidney failure, what we call hypoglycemia, that is low blood sugar. Malnutrition may set in, coagulopathy, hyponatremia, that is low level of sodium, DVT, that is deep venous thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, vasospasm of cerebral artery, or even what we call Wernicke's encephalopathy, normally presenting with ataxia, poor gait. Yes, thank you for watching. Subscribe to Pamli Vlogs, turn on notification bell for more videos.